was called out of town at the last minute, and I just want to thank anybody for all this mentorship with her.
So my name is Brandon Washington, and I'm a political science major here at CSUB. And the title of my presentation is Resurgence of Hope, African American Political Participation. Now, in order to first understand political participation amongst African Americans, we first must understand the historical context. African Americans have been vying for equality when it comes to politically since the beginning of the founding of the nation. However, because of slavery and Jim Crow laws, they were unable to do so until the Civil Rights Movement, which began in 1947 and ended in 1965 with the Voting Rights Act. Now, there were many coalitions working for equality during this time. The Congress of Racial Equality, Southern Christian Leadership Organization, Black Churches, and also National Association for Advancement of Colored People, they all work for equality. During this time, they believed that through peaceful demonstration that they can show the world how unjust the Jim Crow laws of the South actually were. They did this by participating in freedom rides, bus boycotts, sit-ins, and marches all throughout the nation. Now, what you see here is two graphs, the presidential election and congressional election. On the x-axis, you have the year, and then on the y-axis, we have the percentage of total population. Now, the presidents, you see that in 1968, we have our highest percentage of vote. However, it dropped since then, and then we do see in 1984 increase. And then the congressional election, we see 1966, 1970 increase, and there's a decrease. But we see this increase right here in 1982, 1986, and then this increase in 1984. We can attribute that to opposition of Reaganomics by the African Americans, also as the coattail effect experienced because of Jesse Jackson, who was the first presidential or person of African Americans to stand for our first presidency. And I'll talk about the coattail effect later on in my presentation. People traditionally will participate where the participation benefit is they feel that there's a sense of civic duty, and also that all of this outweighs the cost. However, African Americans have, yes, as I have stated, has had history of obstacles, whether it's Jim Crow laws, slavery, the possibility of being lynched, having to take literacy tests, or so. And then another obstacle is gerrymandering. There's two types of gerrymandering. One is where you pack the district, so you take a minority of a certain type and put them into the same district that there's already a majority minority in this district. Also, this cracking, where you take the majority minority minority population and you dilute it by redrawing the district line, thus diluting it so that the majority minority actually becomes a minority in that district. Now, African Americans traditionally have low turnout. They make up 10 to 12% of the total population during presidential election. They make up also even more or less during the congressional election as well. Now, this is the African American political participation of the total group from 1996 all the way to 2004. And you can see on here that African Americans voted predominantly or overwhelmingly for the Democratic candidate. We see that in 1996, they went to see 84% of the total percentage. And then in 2000, Al Gore received 90%, and then John Kerry received 88% during the election. However, in 2008, we see an increase to 95%, and we can attribute this to Senator Barack Obama being African American. So, the reason why, the theory that explains this is descriptive representation theory. This theory states that representatives should invite their constituents, whether it's that their gender, their ethnicities, or their different minorities. The reason being is that because the representative looks like their constituent, they're more able to embody what the constituent wants. So if a person looks like me, they're able to feel what I feel, and then therefore they're able to actually represent me. And the effect is that they forge a bond of trust between the constituent as well as the representative, and the constituents then therefore become more informed, and also mobilizes the constituents to actually go and vote. Now, in 1994, Dawson wrote a book titled The Black Man, where he turns the phrase the Black utility first. He believed that because of history and that the population doesn't alter, the African Americans are different than any minority group in the United States. And the reason being is that there's no influx of immigration and that the population stays stagnant. It doesn't deviate from that 10 to 12%. And the reason being why the African American group is so different is because of the segregation that happened, because of the Jim Crow law, the electoral requirement, and the racism. What ended up happening was that it forged this bond between them and thus created a separate culture. So it was an us versus them mentality. And also because of that, the African Americans, in order for African Americans to do better in life, that the group fate is tied to individual fate and vice versa. So in order for the individual to do well, the group must do well as well before. Now, going back over the 2008 election, we see that 95% of blacks voted for Obama. We also see that 4% of blacks voted for McCain. That there was no gender gap. That 95% of African Americans voted for Barack Obama, and also 96% of black women voted for Obama as well. This led me to hypothesize that by comparing the past two midterm elections, 2010 would be more likely to have higher participation among African Americans than the 2006 midterm election as a result of Obama. So, what we first did was we took compared the three most highly popular minority groups that vote, which were black, Hispanic, and Asian. And we see that African Americans come out to vote, the total population of African Americans come out to vote 40% of the time, when compared to Hispanic, which was like 20%, and Asians, where it's 21%. And what we used during this study is the U.S. Census Bureau per population study from 1966 all the way to 2010. So, from here we took from as far back as we can go back on the congressional election, from 1974 to 2006, and we compiled the total population with the black reported number, and then we got the percentages. You can see each year's increase with the black reported numbers, and then the percentage during this time increased, like, say it's over the high 30%, 30, above 35%. Then we do see the increase in 1982 and 1986, but we can attribute that to Jesse Jackson running for president during this time. And also in 2006, we see an increase to 41%. However, in 2010, we see 43.5% of total population of African Americans coming out as well. And we also see a 1.2 million increase as well. So what we did as well, we took the mean average of 1974 to 2006. We also took the mean average of 1994 to 2006 as well to attribute to the increase in education during this time. We see that the average is for 1994 to 2006, 39.3%, and 39.5% in 1994 to 2006. So we do see that there was an increase to increase by about 4% during this time. So why does this all matter? This 4% increase is important, especially in congressional years, where we traditionally see a low turnout of any type of participation. Primarily, this is important for Democrats, where we see that that the minority vote is very important for Democrats. Since Lyndon B. Johnson in 1964, I believe, Democratic candidate has won the majority white vote for a presidential election. Also, we see that this coattail effect is accurate, that it benefits all Democrats. This coattail effect is when someone runs for office, people on the lower ticket see the benefit because of the increase in participation. So we can see from congressional all the way to down to the mayor level. And then the black utility basically urges free riding, which is very important because in a Democratic nation, we need people to go out and vote. And especially now where the United States prides itself on being the champion of the democracy. And then also, this is the first time that we've ever been able to test this theory of descriptive representation on a national level, because this is the first time that any minority group has won the presidency on a national level in the United States. It remains to be seen whether or not this occurred in 2012 for the presidential election. And I would like to explain the same surprise. I'm worried about all of my Mr. Cohen, Derek Warren, and Geronimo Campbell.